You're listening to TuneDig, a podcast for music lovers. The premise is simple. We dig into an album to discover what makes it interesting, and then we dig into the crates for a vinyl copy to give away to one lucky winner.
Go to TuneDig.com for your chance to win, and follow us on Instagram and Twitter for more info about the album that didn't make the episode.
Today we're talking about
Metamodern Sounds and country music.
I asked you when we were kind of going back and forth about this record earlier this week, like, do you think there's anything that I've missed in our preparations? And you said, I think thinking there's a big idea to miss would be missing the big idea. And you were kind of joking, but that's a perfect way to describe Sturgill and the phenomenon around Sturgill, especially with this record. There are a lot of heavy, interesting topics covered on this record. And one of them that comes up in some of the reviews and things around this record is this idea of infinite regress. Like, at some point when you try to explain a thing, you use another fact to explain it. And then at some point you just reach the asymptote and you're like, well, it just kind of is. Right. So at some point all knowledge kind of gets to the end of its rope.
One thing we do when we prepare for these episodes is make sure and listen to other podcasts that try to touch on the same topic to make real sure that we're not repeating the same thing that someone else already did for an hour and a half. I listened to several that are supposed to be covering this or doing an interview with someone about this record. 100% of them started by explaining what Turtles All the Way Down means. Instead of trying to explain it in this context to try to help you understand what he's saying, I think it's more important to get that if you don't know what he's saying, you don't get what he's saying, and he's okay with that. Right. He does a really great job somehow of creating concentric circles of the same topic on this record. On top of that metaphysical topic that he's more than happy to cover, this record is also specifically full of drug references. And in both of those cases, it's one of those where if you don't already have some of the background knowledge, and if you don't already honestly have a drive to know what the references are that he's making, you're just going to miss them. And I think he's okay with that. There was even one place in an interview where he was asked, like, from a lyrical standpoint, was there ever a point where you thought maybe some of the spiritual and metaphysical things you're talking about in this Americana record might go over people's heads? And he said, you know, the people that know what I'm talking about, they know what I'm talking about. And the people that have to ask will probably never know. He is perfectly fine with the fact that you don't get an entire thread of references with this. But if you happen to be one of the lucky people who is both interested in metaphysical science and also drug culture, you've got a lot to unpack here.
He did, and he said as much, he did make a deliberate decision to say, I wanted to make a social consciousness record about love just disguised as a country record. He has a long and interesting path getting to this point. A lot of things had to happen in his life for these ideas to converge into these songs. It's a sublime moment, and it kind of took the world by storm to go from doing open mic nights in Nashville bars to signing to Atlantic Records in like 365 days is kind of unbelievable.
I've seen Jesus play with flames in a lake of fire. I was standing in. Met the devil in Seattle. Spent 9 months inside the line. Then
there are a lot of apparent contradictions here, which I think is part of what he's perfectly fine putting forward, because more or less that seems to be what he discovered, is that everything's full of apparent contradictions. That's what the Turtles All the Way Down thing is about. But it's important to note that he made a record filled with drug references at what he refers to as the most sober point in his entire life. But not only had he gotten sober, but he had just found out that his wife was pregnant. It's worth seeing that trajectory play itself out so that you can get here and be surprised by who is making this record at this particular point.
The apparent contradictions thing is a great way to put it. That's kind of one of the basic tenets of mindfulness, right? Is all of these things exist, light and dark, good and bad. They're not forces you can control necessarily. You just need to bring them all into harmony. It's weird to be talking about a country music record and to be discussing this kind of thing, but...
And that's the big idea.
That's the big idea, man. So he's at an interesting crossroads that you mention. He's like, I kind of got to get it together. This path of realizing he's going to be a father and he's got to grow up some. He starts studying all these kind of like deep water, why am I here things like quantum physics, like cosmology, ancient philosophy.
Well, you know, and he mentioned as well that he had a psychedelic experience on mushrooms at which he realized that all of the bad moments in his life were him being drunk, and it took him being on mushrooms and not drunk for him to realize that that pattern that was probably clear to other people became apparent to him, and he started making those life changes to get sober from the types of things that were presenting him with problems. He was literally getting his life straightened out.
Woke up today and decided to kill my ego. It never done me no good, no how. Gonna break through and blast off to the bar door. Hitting them flowers of light, far away from...
About the album itself, I didn't know this until we started researching, because Ray Charles has so many records, but it's a direct reference in title to 1962's Modern Sounds in Country and Western Music, which is a beautiful and moving, by Ray Charles standards even, it's a great Ray Charles record.
I do just want to point out to anyone that's unfamiliar with that record, that's a great takeaway from this that has nothing to do with Sturgill Simpson, really. That record was amazing. Not only is Ray Charles great, but I mean, just the concept of that particular time, he's blurring racial boundaries by adapting country and Western songs into his own style. Some things even go so far as to say Ray Charles helped define country and Western music by specifically putting things in that bucket and choosing to cover them and call them that for the first time. It's a great record, but it's also like a watershed moment.
I mean, that was a time when... if a black artist made it, it was labeled a race record. And it got played certain places and put on certain jukeboxes. And other than that, it was country records or hillbilly records or whatever.
Yeah, and this isn't Ray Charles being a hillbilly. This is
right.
The opposite.
Right.
Taking great country and Western songs and translating it into his style.
I can't stop loving you. I've made up my mind. In memory of the lonesome time.
There's a lot of that sense of the outsider here. And if you read interviews with Sturgill, he references records like What's Going On by Marvin Gaye, Redheaded Stranger by Willie Nelson, records that both of those people were told, this won't get play. This won't be successful. It's too different. So these friction points between art and commerce that you see probably more than anywhere else in the big Nashville machine, there's an undercurrent of that in this whole thing. Nashville has people literally sitting in cubicles and fours and fives cranking out these songs. And you can tell the difference between a song that was written by five people in a cubicle, good as it may be, and a song that one person wrote at the bottom of a bottle in a dark Nashville apartment by themselves.
I've been guilty of focusing too much on the Nashville pop machine, which also existed at the same time that, you know, we're talking so much about these concentric circles. They're also present in some of the genre evolution that I think we're starting to touch on here. Sturgill is obviously very inspired by the entire concept of outlaw country. But that whole set of Merle Haggard and Willie Nelson and Kris Kristofferson and whatever, that whole group had an opposite in Nashville pop, right? Dolly Parton and that sort of thing was its opposite at the time in the 70s.
Countrypolitan.
I don't think I really had an appreciation until trying to map outlaw country from Johnny Cash up through Sturgill Simpson to see that that again, there's really the symbiotic relationship between the pop portion of country and then the ever-present response to it. Our current response to it is more along the lines of that Americana movement that has Sturgill along with Jason Isbell, along with Chris Stapleton, which are all doing a similar deviation from the center. They're all using the same producer. They're literally creating the same sound. But with, you know, Chris Staples occupying a little bit more of the traditional country angle, Sturgill operating a little bit more of the psych and blues angle, and then Jason Isbell just being a little too sad all the time. But they all sound like really similar in the sense that their production style is designed to bring out the organic nature of their songwriting, and it stands in stark opposition to Big and Rich. Dave Cobb is that person responsible for that type of sound, specifically with that group that we pointed out, Chris Stapleton, Sturgill, and Jason Isbell.
I'm still floored by the fact that this was recorded in four consecutive days and mixed in a day and a half for $4,000. Sturgill said they sat down and had one short conversation about it, and Dave was like, okay, got it. And then they just went in and ripped it in 4 days.
A lot of what makes Metamodern, in my opinion, easy to listen to is that it deviates from the norm just enough, but never goes way out into left field or becomes distracting with what could very easily become distracting, which is like a psychedelic influence on otherwise pretty classic Americana or songwriting music. The most clear, interesting moment in the production, I think, is It Ain't All Flowers. I mean, it threatens to become a funk song before the end of the record, basically. There's still a bonus track after that, but I mean, it swells all the way up into this incredible ending. Practically every interview I saw, someone tried to ask Sturgill what the meaning of this was. Like, why did you choose to play something backwards? And he's just describing him like Bob Ross painting a tree in like a landscape. He's like, oh, they're just happy accidents that happened in the studio. It was like the actual phrase he used in one of the interviews.
And I know this is going to look like we're destroying everything. Don't worry about it. We don't make mistakes. We have happy accidents.
One of my favorite things I learned was just how aware Sturgill is of people not getting his simple references throughout this record. So again, going back to the first song, Turtles All the Way Down, in an NPR concert he stated pretty directly, most people don't understand what the song is about. He said, it's about drugs.
I think part of what made me love this record is it came at a time and place where some of the same works that inspired this record, the content of this record, are things that I had recently been reading. And it was like, how did somebody else find this combination of stuff sort of at the same time that I did and then process it into this and like say all the things that I'd been wanting to say about it but couldn't find the word? So this is a crazy list of things. Primarily The Spirit Molecule by Dr. Rick Strassman, which is about people's experiences on DMT, but it's really about if it's possible to achieve a higher consciousness. Pierre de Chardin's The Phenomenon of Man, Stephen Hawking's A Brief History of Time, Emerson's essay Nature, Terrence McKenna's audio lectures, the film Enter the Void, the French film, which he said basically like this culminated into a group of songs about love and the human experience centered around the light and darkness within us all. And then particularly with The Phenomenon of Man, he was interested in that because it supported this idea of a single collective human consciousness and this idea that everything in the universe is spiritually evolving toward an end goal referred to as the Omega Point. Like, this dude went so far as to thank Carl Sagan and Stephen Hawking in the liner notes.
And I'm guessing we both probably identified with his trajectory through these things, because listening to him recount a list of those five or six mind-blowing things all at one time, that's a lot of how me and you